Good afternoon. My name is Ernesto Lerma from the Bronzeville Learning Academy, and I welcome you to the Baccalaureate Ceremony. Baccalaureate Ceremony. On behalf of the class of 2018, I thank you for honoring us with your presence this evening.
Buenas noches. Soy Alondra Campos de la Preparatoria Rivera College High School y le doy la más cordial bienvenida al programa Bachillerato. La generación 2018 agradece el honor de su presencia esta noche.
At this time, I would like to ask my fellow classmates who will be presenting the following to please join us at this time. Rebecca Salazar for the Pledge of Allegiance and Crystal Carvajal for the Texas Pledge from Lincoln Park. Arvin Mejia from Pace Early College High School for opening remarks in English. And Cynthia Alejandra Lopez from the Bronzeville Learning Academy for opening remarks in Spanish.
Le pedimos a nuestros compañeros de la clase que pasen para compartir en lo siguiente. Rebeca Salazar nos guiará en el saludo de las banderas de los Estados Unidos y Cristal Carvajal de Texas de Lincoln Park. Harvey Mejia, Pace, y Cinta Alejandra López, BLA, para el discurso de la apertura.
At this time, ladies and gentlemen, we will ask you to please stand for the presentation of the colors. Presenting the colors this afternoon will be Rivera Air Force JROTC Color Guard under the direction of Sergeant Andrew Garza and Sergeant Darby Grant. The national anthem will be sung by Nicholas Eli Martinez from Rivera Early College High School under the direction of Charles Williams.
Los abanderados de esta noche son del Air Force de la Preparatoria Rivera y Nicholas Martinez de Rivera.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And now the Texas Pledge. Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you.
Thank you. You may be seated.
Good afternoon to the class of 2018 parents and honored guests. Today is a time for celebrating a great accomplishment, and it couldn't have been done without the support of those who played a critical role in each of our lives. I begin by thanking the teachers who worked very hard to ensure all of us obtained the necessary skills to not only become high school candidates for graduation, but to continue our path to a post-secondary education. Not only did you teach us, you also showed each and every one of us that success takes dedication and determination. To all of our parents, thank you for supporting us every step of the way by encouraging us and helping us see how important obtaining an education really is. Today, we begin the next step of our journey. As we end one chapter in our lives, we begin another with endless possibilities. We are the future of our community, and we thank BISD for preparing us. Thank you to everyone here for taking part in one of the most important times in our lives, and welcome to today's celebration.
Buenas tardes a la clase del 2018, a los padres e invitados distinguidos. Hoy es un momento para celebrar un gran logro, el cual no se podría haber realizado sin el apoyo de los que desempeñan un papel fundamental en la vida de cada uno de nosotros. Iniciaré agradeciendo a los profesores que trabajaron arduamente para asegurarse que todos nosotros obtuviéramos las habilidades necesarias, no solo para ser candidatos para la graduación de la preparatoria, sino también para continuar nuestra trayectoria hacia una educación superior. A nuestros padres, gracias por apoyarnos en cada paso, animándonos y ayudándonos a entender la importancia de obtener una educación. Clase de 2018, hoy damos el siguiente paso de nuestro viaje. Sobre todo, nunca olvidemos de dónde venimos y prometamos devolver algo a la comunidad que nos ha dado tanto. Gracias por participar en uno de los momentos más importantes de nuestras vidas y bienvenidos a la celebración de hoy.
Thank you, Harvey and Cynthia. This afternoon, Mr. Carlos Elizondo, Vice President of Ronso Independent School District, Board of Trustees, brings us a welcome on behalf of the school.
Esta tarde, el señor Carlos Elizondo, Presidente de la Mesa Directiva del Distrito Escolar, nos dará la bienvenida. Welcome, Mr. Elizondo.
Good evening, muy buenas tardes, gracias por estar aquí. Como lo pueden ver, este edificio no puede con tantos alumnos ni con tantos seres queridos, pero estamos haciendo lo posible para reconocer a estas personas que están aquí hoy. I'd like to thank everybody for being here. As you can see, we are at a full house. So thank you for your patience, and we're going to do the best we can to honor the individuals that are here before us. Appreciate that. Again, my name is Carlos Elizondo. I'm the Vice President. Mr. Cesar Lopez could not make it today. On behalf of the School of Trustees, Dr. Zendejas, welcome everybody. Mi nombre es Carlos Elizondo. Soy el vicepresidente del Distrito Escolar. Cesar Lopez no pudo estar aquí con nosotros hoy por la noche, pero aquí estamos nuestras mis colegas y la doctora Esperanza Zendejas. I want to first and foremost say thank you to everybody that's here sitting. It is a sacrifice. But a sacrifice that's up on the stage to the left and to the right of you. So I want to make sure that everybody takes a time and look for your loved ones, your parents, your grandparents, brothers and sisters, because you are here because of the sacrifice that they have done for the last 17 to 18 years. So I want to thank everybody that's here. Make sure you make eye contact. Tell them that you love them, because if it wasn't for them, you guys wouldn't be here. Les quiero decir a los alumnos que les den las gracias a las personas que están aquí, sus seres queridos, sus padres, abuelos, abuelas, hermanos, primos, sus seres queridos. Por la razón que ellos están aquí presentes es por el sacrificio que todos ustedes dieron por los últimos 17, 18 años. Y les quiero dar a sus seres queridos, a los alumnos, que vean hacia arriba y que les den las gracias a esas personas. I'm going to keep it very brief because we do have a lot of people that want to speak, and we have very important people other than I and us here that want to say thank you and they want to give you, you know, their speech. But I want to make sure that everybody understands that you are here, and I want you to understand that you are going to change the world. That is something I want to tell each and every one of you. Put on the armor of God. Pónganse la armadura de Dios y cambien este mundo. Ustedes lo pueden hacer. Muchas gracias.
Thank you, Mr. Elizondo. And thank you, Board of Trustees, for all of your support throughout the year. At this time, I invite Dr. Esperanza Sendejas, Superintendent of Schools for the Bronzeville Independent School District, to give us a welcome on behalf of the school district. Dr. Sendejas received her bachelor's in liberal arts from San Diego State University. She received her master's guidance in counseling and also from San Diego State University. She then received her doctoral degree from Stanford University. Welcome, Dr. Sendejas.
Gracias, señora Elizondo, y la mesa directa por todo el apoyo durante el año. Doctora Esperanza Sendejas, superintendente del distrito escolar, nos dará la bienvenida de parte del distrito escolar. La doctora Sendejas recibió su bachillerato de San Diego y su maestría de San Diego State University. Después recibió su doctorado de Stanford University. Welcome, Dr. Sendejas.
Thank you. First of all, class of 2018, we have a few more weeks, but congratulations prematurely, okay? I briefly want to say three words to you. One, appreciative. Second, thankful. And third, resilience. Quiero felicitar a la clase del 2018 y quiero dejarlos con tres palabras. Agradecidos. Todo el tiempo, dar gracias todo el tiempo y tener el aguante, la resistencia todo el tiempo. For the being appreciative, you have a wonderful group of audience here. You are blessed to have parents who have supported you, as Mr. Elizondo alluded to, for the last 18, 19, 20, and in some cases 22 years to get to your high school diploma. And I like to ask the parents of the students to please stand up. And ladies and gentlemen, let's recognize your parents. Parents, please stand up. Thank you. High school students, always be appreciative of the people that support you unconditionally. Estudiantes, todo el tiempo sean agradecidos por la gente que sin condiciones los apoya y los quiere. Dar las gracias, estudiantes, de aquí en adelante, hay que dar las gracias por todo lo que la gente, los amigos, los familiares, los desconocidos hacen por ustedes. Students, always be thankful for the things that strangers, friends, family, and others do for you. And last, resilience. Over this past year, that word has been spoken in many circles. That without resilience, success is not possible. Because resilience is the ability to bounce back from difficult situations. If you're not resilient and you go to college and you have a failure first semester and you can't bounce back on your own, it's gonna be difficult to survive. If you become a business owner, an attorney, a doctor, a teacher, and you have your first failure and you can't handle it, it's going to be hard to survive. So keep that in mind. Strengthen your skills and resilience. And always withstand the winds that may wanna toss you out of your place. Para los estudiantes quiero decirles que hemos platicado mucho por todos los Estados Unidos, está platicando mucho de la palabra resilience. En español quiere decir aguante, quiere decir resorte, quiere decir habilidad de responder a las cosas más difíciles que la vida les trae. Y cuando uno puede responder a las cosas más difíciles, tiende a tener más éxito. Cuando no puede levantarse en la primera caída, es muy difícil que siga adelante en ese camino. Y yo quiero que los estudiantes entiendan que es muy importante que hagan fuerte su carácter para aguantar las cosas que les van a pasar. And parents, I want to share with you that not long ago I was speaking to a father, and he said, you know, it was real hard for me last year to take my son to college and drop him off. I wanted to cry. I wanted to cry so bad because for the first time, I was not going to be by my son. And in this case, it could have been a daughter during a college year. And he said, you don't know this, but when I dropped my son, I held my tears together. I got into my car and I cried all the way to Brownsville. And then my wife could see me crying so much. It was very painful that I went outside and got the watering hose and started watering the grass and watered my face a little bit so nobody could see that I was still crying. And boys and girls, students, it's going to be hard for your parents to let you go, but I know that all of you have very strong wings to fly and to do what you need to do to achieve your dreams. But it doesn't come easy. Hard work is the answer. Resilience, thankfulness, and appreciative. Para los padres que están aquí, hace unos cuantas semanas estuve hablando con un padre de familia que llevó a su hijo al colegio. Y dice, no quise llorar, pero tenía unas ganas muy fuertes de llorar. Me subí al carro y lloré todo el santo rato hasta que llegué a Brownsville, porque sabía que no iba a estar ahí con mi hijo para apoyarlo durante su primer año de colegio. Y luego mi esposa estaba llorando, yo no quería hacerla llorar más. Me salí a regar las matas con la manguera, echándome agua en la cara para que mis lágrimas y el agua se confundieran. Va a ser muy difícil, pero creo que estos alumnos que están aquí enfrente de nosotros tienen unas alas muy fuertes porque tienen hambre de trabajar, van a ser agradecidos, van a dar las gracias y van a aguantar cualquier viento que venga que no los va a tumbar. So students, congratulations to you. Keep up the good work. Gracias.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sendejas, for your words and your support for all of our schools.
Gracias, doctora Sendejas, por su palabra esta tarde y apoyo para todas nuestras escuelas durante el año.
At this time, I invite Priscilla Nicole Davila from the Lopez,
Mr. Solis is the founder of Solis Systems. He designed a password management solution that stored, safeguarded, retrieved, and automatically inputted one's credentials for desktop applications and internet URLs. He created a smart chip-based solution to support cryptographic keys in POS terminals. In addition, he created a mobile electronic medical record, EMR, solution to manage personal health records securely and conveniently. He also designed and helped bring to market a cutting-edge biometric product, as well as designed and implemented a RFID solution that leveraged the world's smallest RFID chip. Mr. Solis has helped multiple state and ITO WIC authorities to develop smart card-based solutions, saving millions of dollars from previous solutions. He specializes in payment systems, cryptographic security systems, biometrics, and RFID and government EBT. However, I want to introduce him as a former BIC student that attended Garden Park and Clearwater Elementary, Central Junior High, and Porter High School. Please help me welcome Mr. Roque Solis.
Thank you. Let me first say that I am honored to be with you, to be here with you today to recognize BISD's graduating class of 2018. I am here to share with you an excerpt of my career as a software developer and small business owner, and perhaps provide some insights as you face your exciting and often difficult career choices, which might commonly be referred to as getting ready for real life. Up until recently, you have all been under the protection and guidance of your parents, guardians, or mentors. But now, you're entering the world as adults, a world that can be daunting at best and tragic at worst. But you don't have to fear. You don't have to stress. You do, however, have to find your place in it. I will share with you three topics that I think describe my life, spanning from my early days until today, my background, my career, and what I've learned. My background: I am a product of BISD, where I can proudly say I spent the first 2 years in my third grade. Yes, I did flunk the third grade, but not because of my grades or because I had a learning disability. I flunked the third grade because my teacher, Ms. Villegas, made the tough decision to hold me back because I was simply not ready to move on to the fourth grade, as I was ill prepared for it. You see, I am an immigrant from Mexico. I come from a place called La Mariana Matamoros. A neighborhood so riddled with violence and drugs at the time that my parents decided to remove me and my siblings from that environment and bring us to this great country, which I believe with all my heart to be the best country on earth. I thank my parents all the time for making that tough decision in 1976. As painful and difficult as it was, I believe it may have saved my life and that of my siblings from destruction. I say this because all of my childhood friends are dead or rotting in a prison somewhere. So yes, I repeated the third grade because I was enrolled when there was only 20 days left in the school year. And Ms. Villegas, then in her first year of teaching, decided to hold me back another year to give me a better chance as a student. I knew I needed help because I didn't speak the language. And I felt Ms. Villegas really cared. And so instead of feeling down or inferior, I felt safe. I felt I could learn in her classroom. Indeed, the following year, I breezed through my reading assignments, read books like Blue Dilly Dilly, Sea Pug Run, and others, which I really enjoyed. And within a couple of months, I was reading at my grade level. But even then, at that early age, I developed a sense of desperation, thinking I was already behind kids my age. I believe this anxiety is what helped me develop into the person I am today, a person who is constantly seeking knowledge to better myself. I want you to know that I have walked in your shoes, lived a life similar to yours, and longed for the same things you long for. But I'm here to let you know that it is possible to reach your goals if you only persevere. My parents worked hard to provide for us. My dad worked at the shipyard building offshore oil rigs for many years until he contracted rheumatoid arthritis, a disease which sidelined him. My mom She worked as a maid sometimes at the shrimp processing plants and even nurseries caring for plants. We lacked many things, but never love and security in our home. Life was hard, and yet my parents always made sure my siblings and I had a meal on our table every day. Being the second to the youngest of seven siblings, I watched as my older brother and sisters dropped out of high school one by one in order to help provide for the family via some minimum wage job. I got my first job at the age of 12, caring for graves at the Brownsville Cemetery, earning a whopping $1 a day. Shortly thereafter, I earned the skill of laying carpet and vinyl flooring and did that for a couple of years until moving on to framing houses with my brother-in-law during the summer vacations. And as I witnessed my oldest brother do, I would give my major portion of my earnings to my mom to help out as it was customary to do in my family. I recall one day at the age of 14 telling my mother as I was giving her my earnings, "Ama, un día me voy a comprar un condominio en el Bridgepoint de la isla." My mom, without hesitation, responded, "Tú puedes, mijo." I graduated from Gladys Porter High School in 1986. I married my high school sweetheart, Felisa, in September of 1987, the year she graduated. God gave us three beautiful girls. My eldest is Marlene, and I'm very proud to say that she is a third grade school teacher at McCall Elementary in Plano, Texas. My youngest is Liliana, a senior at Hofstra University in Long Island, New York. Her passion is activism, and she's really good at it. She'll be graduating next year with majors in history and women's studies and a minor in political science. My third is an adopted one, sort of. Her name is Pita, who is also my sister-in-law, which we raised since she was about 12 years old. Pita actually works for me in my company. My career, I worked at a call center while attending trade school, and this is where my love for technology was born. As I became proficient in the use of the call center application, my curiosity for its internal workings of the system grew each time that I used it. I had never used a computer for work before, and here I was in a large room with 200 other agents using this single function computer to conduct business in a large scale. This is fascinating, I thought. So I began to pay more attention in school and began to learn more of how these wonderful machines worked. I learned about what powered them, what makes them malfunction so much, and how humans play a pivotal role of keeping them operational, even though we often think of them as being fully automated. I mean, I had an idea of how they worked from the lectures in class, but somehow actually using them like this was more interesting to me. After all, this was real life. And so began my quest to become a career computer programmer, and I've been hooked on technology ever since. At the company where I work, I made a friend who later became my mentor and helped guide me. One day, he loaned me a book on mainframes. The book I noticed he bought from a book club through the mail. A book club for nerds, I thought. Yes, this is what I've been looking for. Mind you, we did not have the internet at the time, much less Google. So finding a place where I could buy this type of literature was like finding a treasure trove for me. I was really excited. My love for technology grew each day, and I could think of nothing else I wanted to do for the rest of my career. One day, I decided I wanted to put to the test and develop what I had learned and develop a real-world application. The call center employed mostly hourly-based employees, and therefore, bi-weekly, one person in the company had to add up all those hours from the time cards and submit them to payroll. This person, I noticed, would stay working late every other Friday. And she told me she stayed up until midnight every other Friday. So I told her, "I can make a system that can help you with that." And she said, "Well, I'll believe it when I see it." I asked my supervisor for permission to develop this application for her, and he declined. He declined, and he didn't provide with a reason. You see, I wasn't counting on being treated differently because of the color of my skin when I got to Dallas. It never even occurred to me that I was different. And some people were very quick to point that out to me. I recall one time that I had just finished a call with a customer, and I heard people giggling and laughing on the other side of my cubicle wall. So naturally, I get up to see what it was about, and I see three coworkers. They had been listening in on my call, and I asked them, "So why are you laughing?" And they say, "It's your accent. You sound like Speedy Gonzalez." And they carried on laughing. So one day, I told my supervisor, "You know, I can really make you look good. If you allow me to take a computer home and a modem, and as long as the company reimburses me for the long distance calls, I can provide support for the system 24/7 and weekends." So he said, "Let's do it." Unbeknownst to him, I was doing this so I could develop that application I had promised the secretary. And so I did it. Took me a few months working nights and weekends, reading manuals, coding, testing. And when I felt it was finally ready, I showed it to the secretary. And she got so happy, she even stood up and gave me a hug. A couple of weeks later, the HR and data processing directors came into my office, which I also shared with my supervisor. And the data processor director asked me, "Did you write this application for the secretary?" And I thought for sure I was getting fired that day. My supervisor stood up and said he was not instructed to work on anything like that. So the director waved his hand, gesturing for him to sit down and addresses me. "I am very impressed with your initiative to look out for the benefit of this company by providing a new tool that will allow us to save time and therefore money." Then the HR director chimed in, "We want to give you a promotion. We want to make you a junior programmer. You now report to the director. Whenever you get a chance, stop by my office and we can discuss compensation." I got a raise. So that was the start of my programming career. With the title of programmer, I knew I now had choices. I always wanted to work on systems that control ATMs. They were new at the time, and I was really interested in how they worked. So I started job hunting and got hired by a company called Electronic Data Systems, or EDS, which was like going to work for Google at the time. I learned a lot at EDS. It was a really good company to work for. I soon got bored of working on the mainframe, but still was very interested in the electronic payments industry, as my intuition kept telling me that is where my future was. I found a job at a company that had a product designed to process electronic payments, and I felt very fortunate to have been hired by them. The reality, though, was that I was hired to fill a quota, a minority quota, and due to some policy known as affirmative action, the company had to allow so many people of minority to work there. So of course, someone had to let me know that just to keep things interesting. But I really didn't care anymore. I was committed to become the best programmer I could be. In this new company, I was assigned to a project that took me to Paris, France. I commuted to Paris for 2.5 years, staying there 3 weeks at a time. I was developing the system that was to become the core of electronic payments in an amusement park called Euro Disney. In 2001, I was working for a different company that specialized in smart cards. I became sort of an expert in cryptography there. However, I was laid off after 9/11 and the recession that followed it. So I became a freelance programmer, which is what I had planned on doing anyways. This just came 5 years too soon. And I founded Soli Systems, a company focused on professional services and consulting in the electronic payments industry. I developed our flagship product in 2010. It is based on a chip card and is used in EBT, or electronic benefits. It is used by 10 state governments and 2 Indian tribe organizations. This product, we call it EWIC, is used in a subsidy program called Women, Infants, and Children, or WIC. And we have sold over 5 million of these cards to date. If you ever see someone in a grocery store hanging with a Lone Star card, that is our product. We won the contract with the state of Texas for EWIC cards by beating out the company that had laid me off in 2001. This, of course, was one of my most fulfilling moments of my career. Solis Systems has customers and suppliers in Europe, China, Mexico, and South America. We employ 11 people here in the US, 2 in Mexico, 22 in Argentina. We are small, but we are very efficient and talented. Through my company, I have traveled to at least 20 countries, including Nepal, of all places, because I believe that with today's technology, borders and distance, they don't really matter much anymore. We have an office in Allen, Texas. Almost everyone in the company works remotely, including myself. I work from a beach house at South Padre. But I have guys in Pennsylvania, Connecticut, New York, Austin, Brownsville, and we never miss a beat. I just hired a vice president for sales to free myself from that role and return to the work I love best, which is technology. These are exciting times, guys and gals. Technology has changed our lives forever. The things that are coming down are just short of miraculous. The advent of having the ability to control a device from your phone through the internet should make even the most technologically inept person excited. The capabilities brought to us through machine learning combined with artificial intelligence and the Internet of Things can make the technology pundits nervous, but enthusiasts jump for joy. Every year, I attend 2 technology trade shows in Europe where I learn not only of new products and technology offerings, but also I get to see where the industry is going 3 to 4 years ahead of time. For instance, there is a technology coming that will revolutionize the world, not unlike the World Wide Web in the 90s. I'm referring to blockchain. Blockchain is the underlying technology of the cryptocurrencies, such as Bitcoin, Ethereum, Litecoin. And blockchain, combined with Internet of Things, artificial intelligence, and machine learning, is what will give us things like self-driving cars, trucks, useful robots, and other technology that we only thought possible in the movies. You may say, I don't really care about technology, so it doesn't really matter to me. It should matter, because technology is already embedded into the very fabric of our society. Avoiding it is impossible. You don't have to be a technologist to make it in the real world. Social media apps like Facebook already give you a peek of how transparent technology really is. I know some of you may try to stay off of Facebook because us parents are in there, but you already see that this app has transformed many people for better or for worse. You don't have to be a computer scientist to come up with the next big thing in technology. You just have to find what you love and trust that your intuition will guide you. Today, companies like Google, Amazon, Uber, they don't only employ computer scientists. They are often more interested in the humanities, how society works, and then they apply technology to solve the problem or bring about a new discovery in hopes that society will embrace it. What I learned is that hard work really pays off, and success is what you make it to be. You must seize opportunities and pursue your dreams, but also understand that life has a way of hitting you in the head when you least expect it. Case in point, A year ago in March, my wife was diagnosed with stage 4 lung cancer. She never even smoked. In fact, she exercised daily and ate well, and by all accounts, led a healthy life. She succumbed to that horrible disease on August 21st of last year at the age of 49, 2 weeks before celebrating what would have been our 30th anniversary. My girls and I suffered a tremendous hardship due to that event. And as we continue to mourn our loss and remember her, we have, as a family, decided to press on, because that's what Felisa would have wanted us to do. So you decide what you want to do and learn what price you have to pay, including university diplomas, interning, or paying your dues in some chosen profession. Or perhaps the price is just good old-fashioned hard work, and you must resolve to pay that price to realize your ambition. In your jobs, do the little things right. Always try to over-deliver, because if you cannot do the little things, you cannot do the bigger things right. It's all about habits of success. Most of all, remove your self-doubt. Self-doubt is your greatest enemy. Accept criticism with grace, but don't be driven by the critics. You must follow your own path and seize your own opportunities. So go out and make your parents and teachers proud. And above all, find your place in this world. Thank you.
Superintendente de la doctora Sendejas y la generación 2018 le dan las más sinceras gracias al señor Roque Solís por haber sido el orador de esa tarde. Gracias por su mensaje y palabras de motivación.
To conclude our program, Melanie Bailey from Rivera Ready College High School and Guillermo Antonio Arredondo from Pace Ready College High School.
Melanie Bailey y Guillermo Antonio Arredondo ofrecerán unas palabras para cerrar.
As the celebration comes to an end, we would like to thank everyone who came out today, as well as our honored guests. Class of 2018, the time has come to start our paths towards the future. Remember, behind you are your memories, and before you are your dreams. Around you, all will love you, and more than anything within you, all you need. Thank you to everyone for joining us today, the parents, the students, everyone who came out. But most of all, I'll see you all at graduation.
Celebración llega a su fin. Me gustaría agradecer tanto a todos aquellos que vinieron como a todos nuestros invitados de honor. Generación del 2018, ha llegado el momento de comenzar nuestra senda hacia el futuro. Esto ocurriendo, han de recordar que detrás suyo están sus recuerdos, delante suyo sus sueños, a su alrededor todos los que los aman y dentro de ustedes todo lo que necesitan. Gracias a todos por acompañarnos hoy. Nos veremos en la ceremonia de graduación.
as this celebration comes to an end, we wish to thank all of our special guests, the students, the sponsors, the directors, to the Bachelorette Select Committee, parents and guests, and the most important, class of 2018, for making tonight's program a success.
Queremos agradecer a todos nuestros invitados de honor, a los estudiantes, a sus asesores, a sus directores, al comité organizador de este evento, a los padres, sus invitados y, por supuesto, la generación de 2018 por haber hecho de esta noche todo un éxito. We ask you to please remain seated until our students leave the building.